Hey, this is Neil Brennan. This weekend, I'm going to be in Baltimore, Maryland at the Comedy Factory, June 7th, 8th, and 9th. Then the 10th through 14th, I'll be in New York. I'll be at the Comedy Cellar and the Comic Strip every night. I'm also doing Hannibal's show, The Knitting Factory, on Sunday, June 10th. And then Providence, Rhode Island, I'm coming this Friday, June 15th, at the Spot Underground. Shit will sell out, son. Fuck with it.
Hi, it's Moshe Kasher. I'm off the road for about 5 months, but I will be at the Comedy Store in La Jolla over my birthday weekend, July 6th weekend. So come fuck with me there. Follow me at Moshe Kasher, MosheKasher.com, for all your Moshe Kasher-related stuff. Buy my book, y'all.
Hi, this is DJ Doug Pound. I'll be in Chicago July 27th with Tim Heidecker and Neil Hamburger. Also in Madison and Milwaukee the 28th and 29th of July.
And our guest today, Mr. Trevor Noah, where are you going to be?
Hi, my name is Trevor Noah.
Very good. Good job,
yeah,
man.
Great.
Per our conversation, I am confirmed for the following dates. June 14 to 17.
This proper ass motherfucker.
Arlington Improv. That's the Arlington Improv in Texas. Six shows, Thursday to Sunday. Must arrive Wednesday for Thursday morning press.
They don't need to know the whole contract, man.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's start it.
Let's fuck with some champs.
Now you're fucking with the champs.
Ninja.
Yo, Landy Fester.
Jack Pato.
Fucking with the champs.
DJ Doug Pound and Quick.
That's some real South African grimy gangster shit, man.
Do you guys play this normally? Or
no, that was for you, dude.
I was like, where on earth did you find Jack Parrow? And why? I was watching.
I'll tell you where on earth we found it.
That was very interesting.
South Africa.
Doug knew that you were. I told him you were South African at six.
And so you
seven,
chose Jack Parrow.
I've never heard of Jack Parrow.
Well, that was Diane Ward with special guests featuring Jack Parrow.
I see. Okay.
Oh, we've jumped the gun once again. Ladies and gentlemen, our guest today is a South African monolith, a bigger force in South Africa than the aliens in District 9. He has now made his American debut and is taking over here as well. It's Trevor Noah.
You do great. Yes, Trevor Noah.
Comedian Trevor Noah.
Yes, Trevor Noah. Here's a clip.
What happened was there was a funeral on the weekend, and what happened was there was a lightning storm, and lightning struck the people at the funeral, and 9 people were killed instantly. There's nothing funny about that. 9 people dead, gone. Nothing funny at all. Although it must have been a bit weird because, like, you know, you're there because someone has died, and then it's a bit awkward now. You don't know if you carry on here or do you. You know, but it's a bit, you don't know. And then you're like, do you put them in? Because there's like, because you know, there's going to be like one uncle who's like, no, there's space, put them. I must buy another box. Just.
You're a big comedian in South Africa, right?
I'm the second biggest comedian.
Well, who's the first?
In South Africa.
You can say that, really? You can just say that.
I don't know. I just like saying that because then it's random, isn't it?
But is it real?
I don't know. I mean, I'm confident in my second spot.
But are you? But you're very popular. You did movies and shit.
I have. Yes, I've done a few films, and I've got my specials that have done well, and number one selling DVDs in the country ever.
Who
for
is
stand up? So
who's the number one stand up in South Africa?
I don't know.
It's you, motherfucker! Come on, dude, with your false humility.
No, you don't know who number one, because we don't race against each other, so you never get a chance to say I won. So you have to go.
Really?
Like, who's
the number one selling DVD guy?
Yeah, but that's just selling
that's
DVDs.
Just a number.
That doesn't
you
mean number one.
Trying to,
no, but
yeah, you were number one. You won the DVD race.
Name another
DVD
comedian from South
that's
Africa.
Winnie Mandela.
Name anyone.
Winnie Mandela is funny as fuck. She's funny.
Her first death.
Nelson Mandela was funny. Nelson Mandela was very
for real. Nelson Mandela
is
a funny guy.
He's still alive. Funniest, though, right?
Yes, but he's old, he's senile now, but he's, man, that guy was funny.
He was actually
some
funny.
Of my favorite lines of his when he for instance when they put his face on the currency, but it was the Kruger Rand. They had the special edition Nelson Mandela, and they asked him in the press conference, they said, Mr. Mandela, how do you feel about having your own money? And he said, that's how you know you've made it, when you have your own money. No more socializing with poor people for me. And then no one laughs because they don't know he's funny. He has jokes, but he was very funny, man.
I
think that's the only way you survive 27 years in jail is with jokes.
So
or you rape everybody, or you're in charge of the block. You don't have to. That's the only way. You got
to
be funny.
I think to Trevor's credit,
join the fucking Arab, or the fucking white,
the Arab.
I like
Arab
how you just painted Mandela as like Adebisi from Oz.
Yeah. Well, he's African. They're both African. It made a lot of sense.
I mean, yeah.
No, I think what he means is out of you spend 27 years in jail and then come out a Nobel Peace Prize motherfucker.
Yes.
But I heard some crazy shit about Nelson Mandela recently. It wasn't on the Champs, was it?
This story.
This is some crazy shit. I was talking to a dude who will remain nameless, but who is a filmmaker, and he got way high up in... He was making a documentary with, I think it was MSNBC, or one of these big, big, big muckety... And because of all of this, the documentary they were making, these dudes from the high, high, high ups in CIA ops came to be interviewed. And they were telling him stories of like some of the craziest shit they'd seen. And one of the things that they told him was about Nelson Mandela. When Nelson Mandela was being, and maybe you already know that, maybe this is common knowledge in South Africa, I don't know, or maybe I'm straight up breaking some government secret shit.
That would be amazing.
But a lot of it was theater. He'd been in prison for a long time. They knew he was going to get out of prison and become the leader of the country, or at least they knew he was going to become the leader of the civil rights movement.
Yes.
And so they brought him out of prison long before the public knew.
Yeah. But, I mean,
started to train him, because he couldn't just go from being in prison to be like, oh, now I'm a world leader. And also they were like, by the way, your woman has been fucking cheating on you, embezzling all your money. So they brought him out, put him in a room, trained him to get back into the world, and then put him back.
To act unprisony,
and then put him back in prison for like a day, and we're like, we're releasing him.
Right. So we didn't like start just punching.
Well, basically,
exactly.
Yeah. Well, what they did was, look, a lot of people don't actually know that, but what they did was they put him in. He was under a house. They made a prison a house, and it was a prison, and he had guards, right. But they fed him well, because they were basically like, if we're going to choose, because there were many black guys that were poised to be the next president,
mm-hmm.
He was the friendliest choice. He was the least likely.
Dude in prison.
He was the least likely to kill every single white person.
Right. Fair enough. Right.
Well, that's Do you know about Rosa Parks?
No,
she sat in the front of the bus a week before, and did nothing happened, and then like they planned it for a more public day,
right?
And that's so. There's always, and the March on Washington is called the Farce on Washington,
right? So it's like there's theater to even the most sincere moments in history.
Yes,
there's theater to that too.
Yes. Look, guys, there's a lot of the world is fake.
That Rodney King beating was choreographed. We both went to combat school.
Yeah, that's right. Rodney King was actually an LAPD operative.
Yeah, he did stage combat.
Yeah, stage combat. I think he actually still is one of the top earning stunt. Right?
Where do we begin with you?
What do you mean?
Because I've spent time with you. I've spent time with your lovely girlfriend.
Thank you.
German. And when I say German, with a capital G... Moshe.
With a capital K.
You are wicked! I mean, blonde.
Yeah.
Fucking German.
Do you take it out on her?
Do I take what out on her?
Oh, and we should know that you're mixed. Your father's German and your mother.
Be nice to her.
My father's Swiss German, and my mother's Xhosa, South African. So
that's
black.
Say that again.
That is black.
Say that
again. Did you do a click clack in there?
Hold on, man.
Did I do a click clack?
Oh, Trevor, just so you know, this is what the whole podcast is going to be like.
That's funny. Did you do a click clack?
I thought we were having
audio issues.
No. That's okay. Not. It's not a click in your.
Say something about black folk.
Yeah, it's a click. Xhosa.
And you got to say that every time.
Well, he says it naturally.
How do you say it without it? Oh, no, you have to say Neil. Do I have to pronounce the N every time?
It's the same thing.
Xhosa.
That's how it's pronounced, though.
It's not like I prepare myself to make the click sound. I don't go, oh, here we go.
Right.
Xhosa. No, it's just right. It's
you're
the
like,
word.
Fuck
it's
it. Like, I don't feel like
no.
saying the click.
It's like if I say
Xhosa.
If I say L'chaim, I don't say L'chaim because there's white people around.
That's exactly.
I know black people say L'chaim.
But that's wrong. They mispronounced
the
word.
It's mispronunciation.
They still got beat up for being Jewish. So how wrong was it?
Wrong.
All right. So you were born in South Africa to a black mama.
Yes, I was.
And a white father.
Yes, this
in
is correct.
In what year?
It was
1984.
Yes.
So this was still during.
No, I'm sorry.
We use the same numbers.
Well, really, don't look. Don't do us any favors.
As a Jew, I think you'd be more sensitive. Thank you, Moshe.
If you want to throw a click in, fucking be my guest. Go ahead.
In 1984, question: was there weird tension about interracial dating at that point?
Yeah, it was. What my parents did was illegal. They didn't give. They literally didn't give a damn. They were just like my mom. I ask her about this all the time. I go, why? And she was like, well, I love the fact that I wasn't allowed to do it. So there were underground clubs where black and white people would mix. And then my mom was like, I'm rolling with a white man. I don't care if I go to jail. She was literally like, I don't care.
Shit. Does she have cornrows?
No, she didn't.
Oh, okay.
Real black people don't have cornrows.
Like, but I have a real question, though. I'm making jokes.
Girls on vacation do. Go ahead.
But question. In South Africa, are there... You know how in America there's like... there's white people that act black and want to be black?
Yes.
But is that a thing?
Are there white people that make click noises?
You know what's funny is every white person that acts black all over the world acts American black. Just act black. It's not just random black. It's not African black. It's not French black. You act American black.
But there's a lot of African black people that act like American black people.
Yes, but you must remember, it's not black folk. It's aspirational, though.
It's hip-hop, actually.
Yeah, because American black people influence the world more than anyone else in terms of a pop culture. You know what I mean? The music, the style of dress, the
language. By the way,
language.
Our intern just waved. You're a fucking intern on a white podcast. He took credit for it. Like, here I am.
Yeah, you know how we do.
Culture over here. Dressed like fucking Drake. A Canadian
I'm a
black guy.
I'm a slave with your daddy.
Working on a white podcast. Was it actually illegal or was it like...
I was born as a crime. It was illegal.
Is it like weed illegal or is it like a fucking...
No. It was like you would... Luckily, my mom, because I think they were more lenient to women, my mom would pay fines. She'd spend maybe a weekend in jail if they were caught. So for instance...
Baby fines.
Well, it was a lot of money back then.
Mixed baby fines.
You were literally born a criminal.
I was born a crime rather than... I was the victim. No.
It's more racist if you're born a criminal. Yeah.
I wouldn't commit the crime.
Sounds harder
if you're
born.
I couldn't be the criminal.
Okay.
I couldn't be born. I am the source. Anyway, so the...
You are the source.
Don't hate the player, right?
So
hate the source.
So they would hang out, and like my mom she rented an apartment next door to my dad, and then but then he would act like he owned both of them, and she was his maid.
Your life was theater too,
which was
she would act like his maid and not just
when
freaky
because when the police no because when the police would come then you'd have to go why
be
they,
like clean this up
they'd be like why is there the black woman next door and you'd go oh no that's also my apartment that's just she's just cleaning
and they'd be like that's your white
that'd
German
be fucking
maid
kidding me
no she's black.
But your mom's black.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Kasa, remember this? We had this whole discussion
I'm
five
sorry.
Minutes ago.
Yeah, I got twisted up. So your dad's white.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
All right.
She loved white guys, and then he...
That's
well,
a hard thing to pull off, by
what?
The way. The white guy getting a black girl is a hard maneuver.
You think so?
A black dude getting a white girl is way easier.
No, that I don't agree with that
Wait,
at all.
Wait, the white guy getting the black girl is a hard maneuver. You mean like in the streets today?
Yeah, just right today. It's harder as a white guy to get a black girlfriend than it is for a black guy to get a white girlfriend.
Oh, I think that's true. Yeah. Although I think it's easier now than it was when
okay,
I was
it is okay, easier. Not where I'm from.
Interesting.
No.
Take us through that. Because, you know, the typical thing will be like, you know, a black girl will be like, you know, I'm not fucking with this white motherfucker.
Yeah, fucking white boy ass motherfucker.
Little nerdy.
Whereas black dude is like ripped, giant hog of a
cock. But then when you have a legacy of racism behind you, you must remember we're still a young democracy. So back home, I mean, you don't.
Yeah, you guys don't have a legacy of racism behind you. You're just a young democracy.
No, we have
God
the legacy.
God knows South Africa doesn't have an effort. Yeah, what am I talking about?
Okay.
But in terms of you look at how in American media, the portrayal of black people is they're very cool. They just, you know what
yes.
I mean? Like now when you see Barack Obama, he has they always talk about his swag. They've never said swag about any of your other presidents. Bill Clinton, I believe.
Bit.
No, but they say that now. They go, oh, he's swag, just like Bill Clinton had swag. But they never said swag when Bill Clinton was president.
Right.
That was not used. No one said that. They were just like, this
they didn't
guy.
Use, well, no one
In
used
fact,
the
they
word.
Said they said he was black. That's what they said.
Yeah,
and then now with Obama, now they go, okay, Clinton was swag. It wasn't black. It was swag.
Well, yeah, that's just, yeah, we're just talking about semantics.
So, yeah, but still, but that's my point.
But I don't.
Who
but,
started
but
swag?
We're not talking about. I'm talking about black dudes have swag. Black girls don't have swag.
What?
Black girls don't have swag?
Oh, I get what he's
generally,
saying.
Generally, that's why it goes back to that thing of like, it's harder. Why is it easier? How are black women at a premium more than black dudes in South Africa?
Well, I don't know about a premium. That's a difficult. Let me put it this way: if you're a black girl and you have a white guy, then it's it's not as much of an achievement as when you're a black, as when you're a black guy with a white girl.
That's fair.
Then the black guys are like, whoa, really? You got a white girl? Wow. Guys. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Whereas when a white guy has the black girl, then it's just like, well, I mean, you can choose as you have for many generations. And you have chosen thus.
I get what I want.
You have chosen thus, right. And therefore we, you know.
Did right. your mother have white features?
White features?
White physical features.
She was black, so what do you
no,
mean?
No, but she,
what do you mean?
What I mean is, there are black...
I don't understand what you mean. I don't understand what you mean by that.
There are black women that, quote-unquote, have white... Halle Berry has white features.
I do not know what you're talking about.
I know, you're scared.
I see.
I'm not scared.
Okay.
I disagree.
A more classic...
No,
I see
you
what
can
you
disagree.
Mean.
It's true. Look up white feet. It's a thing. Blackwell, am I wrong about this?
Oh, now the black guy's involved. Now
yeah, you have white features. Exactly. You have white nose, white lip, like white features.
I don't think Halle Berry has white features.
She does. I can see
she
what
does.
Neil is saying. She doesn't have
she
doesn't have white.
She has narrow nose.
No, no, it's not white features. It's really closer. Because, I mean, at the end of the day, that's why it's how you look at what's attractive, what's considered attractive over the world.
Standards, yeah.
Yeah, so then we go, it's closer to the standard of a white. You know what I mean?
Right.
Oh, you white.
Whereas, like, a lot of Russian people will have, like, bigger noses. Or like, when you go to that area
black,
of the world.
Black Russians.
Well, I mean,
especially.
Right, because, I mean, I'm a Jew, and I straight up am, I think, maybe genetically pre-programmed. I think big noses are, I'm thinking.
Did you say genetically as a joke?
Genetic, no, that was, a, oh, that was, I, like, that was
okay.
like my way of saying it.
I thought you
he'll slip it in when he can.
But I
see,
I find big noses hot. I think they're hot. I'm into them.
I
you
like
mean,
big
okay,
noses.
When you say big noses, do you mean the arch of the nose itself,
like,
or do you mean the width of the nose? What do you mean by
like
I like big noses?
Jew nose, arch, I guess.
Oh, so you like Jews then?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Well, you're Jewish. Isn't
yeah.
that normal?
Well, it... I mean, no, I mean, in the same way that some people like, you know, to date outside, you know...
No, but you're dating inside, so that's normal then.
I guess. It's just big noses.
It's like dogs. It's like dogs liking dogs.
It's not
like,
big,
you
it's
know
not
what
like dogs,
is
okay?
Like, why,
it's not
you
like
know,
dogs, Trevor.
It is.
Hey, you know what white features is like? Can I put it in your parlance? It's like a shiksa.
Yeah, okay, right.
It's like
so
a
it's
what?
Like a black...
Want to explain
a
yourself?
Shiksa is like a very white Aryan looking...
You're going to think that I'm saying this to try to sound... enlightened, but I'm not. I have literally never looked at a black girl and thought, oh, she's got white. She
I never had
white
either.
Looking.
I heard it from black people. I heard the term white features from black people. Like,
you
I wasn't
just
like,
down.
I'm like, you know why I like her? White. Her nose makes me comfortable. I feel
well, I mean,
at
look,
home.
If you look at it in Hollywood and stuff, the generally the woman
Dorothy
who
Dan
make it.
White features.
The,
yeah.
the black women who make it further and will be in the mainstream movies are the black women with more white features. I
are there white people
saying.
With black features?
Yeah.
Although,
yes,
sure.
they
are.
And
yes,
can I have an
are.
Example of one?
They are. They're very few and far between, but they are. They don't become famous because if you're white with black features,
they are stuntmen.
You just lost in life. That's like harsh.
Wait. I'm trying to think. A white person with black features. There are some... Russell Crowe? Something
no,
about Russell Crowe?
No.
No,
no.
Well, have you ever met a person that is that wants, maybe this won't resonate with you as a South African, but for an American dude, that white dude that wants to be black so hard that eventually he starts to kind of be black.
I completely agree with you.
It's very interesting.
They grow, it's white dudes that hang out with black dudes, and I always pride myself for never letting this happen, and the Beastie Boys too, and Eminem never let this happen.
Right.
They grow the chin strap beard.
Right.
And they start, their faces start to look.
It's very
you guys
awesome.
Are singing.
I'm not, yeah, we both came to this independently.
MC Search would be an example of a person like that.
Yes. Search always looked a little Jewish, but he's not, he's a good example. There's a guy named Pete Rosenberg who's a DJ who absolutely, and it's like dogs, or people becoming...
It's not like dogs. Yeah, it is like, not like dogs.
Can we just...
You don't compare black people to dogs.
So Chinese people, in many ways, are like dogs. Let me just start off with
no,
that.
No, it's like animals, it's owners looking like their dogs.
We have white people problems.
Whoa, okay,
that's
whoa,
what
whoa.
We have.
What do you mean owners looking? So you're saying the
black
white guy looks
the
like
owner.
The black people?
Who
white people
are the owner.
Oh, okay.
So
white
I was just
people
like
white people looking like they're...
No,
okay,
I would never... Not
if you
want to
get racist about it.
I'm just
you're born a crime.
I'm just asking.
So
just...
Jacob Siroff, you know the comedian Jacob Siroff? Anybody know him? Friend of mine. He's got a brother. They were both super into hip-hop and super wanted to be black their whole childhood.
And so, now they're black.
Well, one day Jacob's brother came home. They're twins. And he goes, hey, man, somebody said I look mixed today. Like he was bragging.
To me, you seem like a dude who knows what's up.
That's fucking hilarious.
That is the perfect human being, isn't it, though? I mean, you have all the privileges of a white person, but then you have the swag of a black man. That
right.
Is that not the ultimate goal? Is that not what you want to strive to achieve?
The question really becomes when a white dude becomes that black. And it usually connects to being like ghetto. It's not just being black. It's not like you're a black African American studies professor.
Yes.
You're like
yes.
A gangster.
Okay.
Is what
okay.
You're trying to be.
Yes.
Do you still have the privilege?
You still have the privilege.
Yeah.
Because
you have
because
that
the
what
police.
Mooney, what Paul Mooney calls the complexion for the protection.
Right. But I'm saying if like if that dude walks into a liquor store with sagging ass pants, a big ass gold medallion.
They will, if he walks in at the same
you know
time
what?
As a well dressed black man, they will still
they'll
look at
the black
man.
Yeah.
Yeah. They will. They will.
Stay
kneel.
Ghetto.
No,
they will
right.
Kneel unless they've been robbed by the white guy before or a white guy that looks similar to him.
That, if I'm wearing an overly hip-hoppy outfit and not I don't really anymore, but if I'm wearing like a big like fur lined jacket in New York and I hail a cab,
yes,
I will not get cabs.
But they don't see you, they see the fur on
right,
the jacket. They
see
the black
outline.
They see the black clothes. That's
they
what
see
I'm
the
saying.
Black features.
Maybe yes. They're in the pita. You know,
maybe yeah.
The cab drivers are doing that.
But have you ever tried rolling up your sleeves on the jacket and then putting your white
I've
arm out?
I've done the thing. I've done
right.
More
or
than
just pull
more
the hoodie back. Hey,
dozens,
it's me, guys. I'm one of you.
Dozens of times I've hailed cabs. I've been with black people and hailed a cab and tell them to hide.
Yeah.
And then they like come sneaking up. Then we all go to Brooklyn to rob this motherfucker. No,
wow. But you're the Schindler of cabs?
Yeah, basically.
Schindler's
cab catcher.
So you were born a crime, and at what point did that message start to become resonant to you? Did it ever? Did you ever feel like in the midst of that racism?
You know what's the great thing for me is I grew up black. Now, because my
me
mother
too.
And I basically had to move to the townships. In South Africa, everything was broken down to the finest degree of your race. So like it wasn't just black. It was what tribe are you from?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So even for me, when I walk around in America, I go, oh, yeah, that's a black guy. But then he would be from that tribe and he'd probably be from that tribe. And you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you had to choose. So I could have gone to, I don't know, extended light-skinned family if I could have found some, which I didn't, but I had to go with my mom. So I had to downgrade according to the government and go live in the black, you know, in the townships, which was Soweto at the time.
Where's your dad?
Well, he still stayed in the city. He was white.
But you didn't stay with him?
No, I couldn't.
Oh, because
he was
a
white.
Crime.
Yes.
Right.
And we kept saying, like, that's
my
maid.
He's also my maid. This
he's
little baby is my maid.
That's basically
that's
what
baby
happened
maid.
Is when I got bigger, then it was like, okay,
maid,
the maid, this thing doesn't work anymore because who is this child? In fact, on my birth certificate, they couldn't even write who my father was because then there'd be shit. People would go to jail.
That's so fucking crazy.
So my father, they just wrote some dude from Swaziland. That's how they justified the light-skinnedness.
Right.
They're like, yeah, there's light-skinned people in Swaziland. We'll let you.
I'd like to see that long-form birth certificate. Check that out.
So you moved to where did you say? Soweto?
Soweto, yeah.
Soweto.
Soweto.
Yeah.
The Southwestern Township. That's actually what it stands for.
Mm-hmm.
That was where most of the unrest was, correct?
That's where it was the biggest.
It was literally a ghetto. Literally
yes,
an actual
yes.
ghetto.
But yes. Ghettos there are fucking ghetto. There's
but I don't
like
mean
City
ghetto.
Of God.
I don't mean ghetto like bad neighborhood. I mean it's both bad. It's an actual ghetto, like
yes,
the original.
It's an actual ghetto.
It's a township. It's
stay
ghetto.
Like for instance, my toilet was outside. You had to walk to the toilet. So at night you'd pee into a bucket, and then if you needed to take a shit, you had to walk outside to go and do what you had to do. There was
how
no,
many shits were you taking? A week, and how many would you have taken if you had?
I would have taken way more shits
house.
Had I had an indoor toilet, because that was. I mean,
yeah,
I remember
you must have held in.
Yeah, when I first started, shits. I mean, the worst. Have you ever been to a long drop? Have you ever used one?
With
a long drop?
Oh, sure.
I like the sign of that.
Outhouse.
Where there's no flushing. There's
yeah,
no
outhouse.
Yes. And then you, it's basically a race against the flies, which is it's not
right.
A great way to shit.
So they're 8 feet down. The like the bottom of the
might
depends
be
how
no,
long
we
your
have
drop
it
is
might, a bit deeper than that, but we try and
how
and
deep?
Then, I don't know. I never
you
measured
didn't jump
it.
In, right?
I didn't.
So the flies were down there.
Yes.
So the
and
idea
then basically
was
you,
I've got to dig
yeah.
it and run.
Let me ask
before
you
they come up.
Did your outhouse have white features?
I've
it
never
did actually.
Heard of such a thing.
No, it's funny
no.
You say that because you know what? That was the next level of your. Like I remember my grandmother's house on my cousin's side was like. Was a horror. It was just a slab of concrete that you sat on, and then my gran on my mom's side, she was a bit more affluent, so she had the white toilet seat
on the slab of
so
concrete.
You felt like you were sitting on a toilet. It had that, you know.
She'd bring you some tea.
Yeah, yeah, and you'd be like, oh yeah, this is you know, this is nice. And then we got the flushing ones, but still they were outdoors, and everyone had to share. This is six people. And
why didn't your dad move you guys out of South Africa? Was that not an option?
My mom just never wanted to leave. I asked her this all the time. I was like, if I had my choice, I would have gone to Switzerland. I mean, that's a great place. You know, well, it's a very nice. And she was like, no, she wanted to stay and rough it out, I guess. I don't know.
Were you guys super poor, or was just the way the neighborhood was?
Everyone was poor. Yeah. So super poor is relative. Because if everyone's poor, then you're not poor.
Right.
So we all lived in the same. Like in my grandmother had a two-roomed house, and there were Let me think. It was my grandmother, grandfather, great grandmother, and it was about nine of us living there. So there was the living room / kitchen / bedroom for the kids, and then there was the bedroom for the adults, and then everyone slept there. And then, you know.
Where'd you get the pussy? I mean, if you needed to get some pussy, where'd you do that at? In the outhouse?
Generally, you did it outside. Like, if you like, you'd play house.
Oh, yeah.
And you'd go outside. House. And then you'd go. And then you'd go to, you just, like, the bushes or whatever.
But I love sex!
I was young, so I wasn't getting pussy at this time.
Oh, you weren't?
and my gran was scared to let me go in the streets because she was worried about me because I wasn't black. So she was
So you get beat up by the black kids, too?
No, I wouldn't. Thought that would happen.
So was that true? Was there racism from the other side?
No, with black people. That's why white people can be black and hang out with black people, because then they just like, because black people don't understand why anyone would want to be black. So if you do, then we're not going to hit you. It's like, well, okay, you've made your decision. You've chosen it, so you have it.
You've made your choice, fool.
Yes. If you get what I'm saying? If you decided to be black, black people wouldn't really alienate you once they get to know you. They'd just be like, oh, yeah, that's Moshe. That's
he comes to the neighborhood. And
that's the dude. That's what he does.
Right. And there are people like that.
And then the new black guys that meet you would be like, who's that white boy?
Sure.
And then it would be like, no, he's Moshe. He's one of us.
And then it would take like 15 minutes to explain that he wanted to hang out with black people. Like, yeah, but why would he want to hang out with us? It's shitty.
But is that a thing? Is that a cultural thing? Like there would be white people that would come around and be like,
not then. Foreigners did, though. It was like a tourist thing. Lots of foreigners would. I meet a lot of Americans here, and they go, well, I came out to South Africa out in the 80s. I enjoyed Soweto. It was great.
It probably made them feel less racist about American
definitely,
racism.
Definitely. Yeah. Yeah.
Like, this is racist. But we've got it all worked out.
To Soweto. That's, I mean, I checked out of racism when I went to that neighborhood.
Yeah, we've got it all. They should come to Memphis. Did you. But there's a lot of like, there's a lot of weird word, not weird words, but like colored.
Yes.
And black,
so, for instance, I am referred to as colored in my country. That's what you had to fill out on the boxes when we still had the boxes, when you had to tick a box. So I would have to choose colored, which is this skin color. So a skin color. So Blake Griffin, they would say is colored. Let me put it like that. Drake, they would say is colored.
Right.
Alicia Keys, they'd probably say colored.
But LeBron James is what?
Black.
And
like black.
Okay.
And then you get what I'm saying?
Yeah,
So Barack Obama, depending on like his sun exposure on that, then he could go either way. You know, he's a darker shade of mixed.
Just arbitrary nonsense.
Yeah, that's literally what it was.
And what did it mean? It was just a distinction. It didn't mean anything.
It meant everything. It meant what jobs you could get, where you could go, who you could. Like in prison, let me put it this way. People wore long pants in prison. So if you're a white man in jail, first of all, they'd be like, why are you here? There's no need for you. But then if you were, they'd give you long pants. And then if you were colored or Indian, then you could also wear like longer clothes. But then black guys had to wear shorts. They were like, you guys don't need long pants.
And too super much black guys had to wear it.
And then they gave you different food as well. They gave you in prison. Yeah, you had different portions of food and different. So white people had bread and stuff, and the black people had to eat what was what you guys have like grits out here. We call it bup. Uh-huh. So it was different portions.
Hey, throw a click in there for me.
It doesn't have a click.
I don't just throw clicks.
Throw a click in.
Just throw clicks.
I'll give you a dollar. Throw a click in. Pop.
Oh yeah, we had bup.
Like, yeah. I mean, everyone knows what you're talking about.
There's a.
That was Doug with an apple sentiment.
It meant everything. It literally. So white people were at the epicenter, and then you had, colored and Indian people just outside them. This is where you're allowed to live in the areas. So you have white people in the city, and then in the suburbs surrounding the city, and then you have Indian and colored people surrounding them, and then you have black people on the outside. So it was like the barrier. And what they would do is they would tell Indian and colored people that they were better than black people. So they'd go, if you guys work hard, you might just be white in a few years' time. That was like the, you know, like if you're on the track, you've been doing really well lately, Moshe. We've noticed your hard work, and there might be an opening coming up in the whites. So, and you laugh at this,
these
but
white
then
people are dropping like flies.
But then no, these guys were crazy. You don't understand. So then you had colored people, which really had been oppressed. They were the children of slaves because they were, you know, from the white settlers that had babies with the Africans. And that's a race that evolved. But now they started hating black people because they believed they were better than black people.
Right.
And then black people believed they were also better than other black people because they broke it down. So
were
it was
they,
just...
Was that by complexion also?
No. Tribe? This was tribe. This was all Got tribe. It. And they broke it down. And it was just the craziest thing ever.
Well,
and
that's
then,
classic colonialism. They would go into a place. They would make false separations between people. And then they would pit them against each other and say,
that's
you
exactly
guys are the
what
ruling
they did.
Class.
Yes. Yeah. And that's exactly what they did. So,
okay. What I've never...
White people don't trust black people.
What I don't understand about you is how you grew up in that. And you're... Not only are you not bitter... You're what I would call sunny as fuck. You're unbelievably sunny.
Surprise, motherfucker.
You have unbelievably good self-esteem.
Because you have two choices. Like
he's the number one comedian. Number two.
Yeah, that's true. It's not like he's some janitor in Soweto still. Like, fuck,
I'm such a sunny dude.
Like
but it's not that. It's not that. You just, look, one was my mom. I honestly, growing up, I did not know that I wasn't black. I honestly didn't know this. I hung out with the kids. And I mean, first of all, in your neighborhood, you grow up together. So when you're really babies, no one's going, goo-goo gaga, why are you black? Or why aren't you black? You just grow up together. They just know you're lighter than they are. That's it. And you just know your family. I'm just like, well, I know my dad's got light skin and my mom's got... I didn't even know that there was black and white, you know? And then when I started... when I went to school, that was the first time... Because then what happened is around 1990... Obviously, 1990 apartheid ended. So they said, okay, no more. They're like, this is wrong. We're really sorry.
Our bad.
Yeah. Yeah. You guys just... Do what you do, and then you guys can run it. And then we're like, can we have our land back? And they were like, no, but we're sorry. And then they didn't even give us casinos like you guys do with the Indians.
Give it time.
So then
they're coming. It took the Indians like 120 years to get them. But
yeah. So then what happened is they started these programs where they'd get black kids to go into the white schools. And I was lucky enough to go into a school where it was like, this is a decent school with books and chairs. Which was just, it was like, wow.
Reminds me of a theory a friend of mine has.
So, like, you know. And so I went to that. Then it was like, now the white kids would go, oh, wow, you speak really well for a non-white guy. And then I was like, yes, because we've had the same English teacher for 5 years, you ass.
Right.
And then the, you know, and then the...
And then he'd go like, he called me an ass. This colored boy called me an ass.
And then they put
and then
you
the
in
black,
a...
And then the black guys,
you
it would be like the first week in
kiss
school.
My ass.
The black guys in school would go, you know, where are you from? What are you? And then I'd speak to them in Zulu or Tswana or, you know, because I could speak a lot of the languages. And then guys would just be like, oh, we thought you were colored. And I'm like, well, I guess technically. And they're like, no, you're not. You can speak it. You know, you're...
Oh, you're black.
You're a black guy. Yeah.
Right. So by the time you got to school, age six, it's... Apartheid's basically over, but there's the system is in place.
I mean, it's in terms of the system is, you know, it's still in effect. The law has been abolished.
It's just like when they outlawed slavery.
So it's basically the same thing. I go, okay, it's over now, and then you don't have money, you don't have education, you don't have anything. So nothing's going to change overnight. You have nothing. You have literally nothing. Well, so then you have to try and
enough.
You know, and then I would say it. I remember the change came in the late 90s. This is when it was now... there was a lot of turmoil early on, like 94, before our first elections, real elections, where everyone could vote
after Mandela.
Yeah, now it was like... Because white people left. They ran. They just... They went.
They're like,
Australia,
oh, okay, we should get out of here.
They literally took off.
They took off. They sold everything. They cashed out. They were gone.
Do you know the percentage?
Right now!
No, I don't. But I mean, let me put it this way. In Australia, for instance, there's over 1 million South Africans in what, the space of 20 years? This wasn't an organic growth. They literally, they were gone.
There was some violence and shit, though, right?
But it was, funny enough, it was amongst black people. It wasn't,
What was the stuff with the farms?
It wasn't. Oh, that's recently. That's you know. That's more recent. This is like farm killings and you know,
okay.
But that's just killings. It's not really. Sometimes people like to make it a race thing. They go, oh, this is a black and white thing. No, it's just a guy killing a guy thing. He just happened to be black and he happened to be white. It's not always. Sometimes it's just a crime. It doesn't always have to be racially motivated.
Yeah, you're.
At what point did the ship come?
What ship?
The one that hovered above District 9 with the prawns. When did that?
Were you a part? Were you there for that?
You know what's funny is District 9 is basically based on our history.
Wait, wait.
Yeah.
That's a metaphor. If you're telling me that District 9 is a metaphor, I swear to God, I'm going to take a swing at you, and it's going to be racially motivated.
So the ship was Nelson Mandela. That's what happened.
Interesting.
Yeah, that's Nelson Mandela was the ship, and he came in, and the ANC and they were like, okay, we just need to get the right parts, and then we're going to get out of this shit. And then they did.
How did you feel as I'm really tempted to be like, as a colored man, because I can never say that in any other context on earth. No, but how did you feel as a person of color? That sounds better. When you started to become aware of the changes that were taking place, because you're stuck in the middle. I mean, and I keep wondering about your dad. Hate your dad in some way? Like,
no,
your dad being fancy, living in this nice place.
Yeah, but then it's not like he didn't. He afforded me those same luxuries when I came to his abode. He did not say to me, "Yeah, that's the black couch, boy." He was just like, "This is your house."
Well, if
but you had to use that long drop. Why couldn't he hook you up with a short
drop? No, but that
was
when I went to his house later on in life. Then I was using the toilets. That was the ablution facility.
Yeah, but I'm thinking maybe beyond even just being allowed to use the white man toilet.
Why couldn't he like hook you up wherever you were staying at?
Hook me up how, Doug?
Financially.
That's one thing he taught my mom, and she credits him till this day. My dad taught her how to be just financially independent, and my mom owns her own company now, and she self-studied and everything because of that.
So you felt zero resentment towards your dad for being on the other side of the tracks.
I was glad I had a dad. What do you mean? I grew up with all my friends. Most of my friends didn't know their dads, didn't live with it. I was like, I'm the privileged dude. I have a dad. I was like, they were like, I don't know where my dad is. I was like, I know where he is. I can't go there, but I know where he is. I was like, and then when I got to school,
he'll wave his handkerchief from his balcony at me sometimes if I go to the
gate. Go there, I have to be dressed in a janitor's outfit.
In a French maid, a short skirt, French maid with a little duster.
And I have a dust mop and a broom.
And then, you know, so I mean, that was great. So even white kids at school, they go, oh, that's my dad, Trevor. What is your dad? And I go, I also have one of those in the same color.
I have a white dad as well.
I have
well.
The exact same model as you, my friend. You'll be shocked to find.
So did you start to, how did that feel for you internally when you started to see the changes happening? Were you thinking, holy shit, everything is going to change? Or you didn't really...
Really glad to be part of the generation that, because we were on the cusp.
Yeah.
I spent like the formative years of my life during apartheid. I got to see the change. I got to see democracy and all of that. And then now I get to see the country, whereas some people grew up and lived their lives in apartheid, and they still have that hatred, both black and white.
Both ways, right.
Yeah,
totally.
Even Indian people and colored people, so-called. There's just so much hatred.
Right.
And then you get kids that are born now who are totally oblivious, and they just like, I don't even know what you guys are talking about. The only beef I know is between Drake and like Common. I don't know who's Nelson Mandela. What's the deal?
That got down to South Africa. The Drake Common thing.
So...
Whenever our people fight, Neil, we take notice.
The drums. You heard the drums? That's how they communicate. They communicate beef via drums. This guy speaks Zulu and Swazi. Even saying that, I sound like a racist Italian guy.
Well, just saying Swazi sounds
he's from Swaziland. That's an actual place. All right, so when did you start doing stand-up?
I started stand-up 6 years ago. I did everything before that. My mom never pressured me.
Was that rapped?
No. I mean, I worked in an arcade. I had odd jobs. I was a taxi driver at one point.
You are a racist sometimes.
No. I did everything before that.
What do you mean, rap?
No, I thought
you made fried chicken?
Everything.
You made drums.
No.
Come on.
Everything in show business. Like, I tried rapping.
No. I tried, like, normal. For instance, I saved up money and bought shares in a taxi and I became a taxi driver. But, like, what you call taxis in this country is we have mini buses that drive a whole bunch of people around on a certain route. Like a bus driver. Yeah, I was a bus driver, but we call them taxis.
And you own the bus?
Yeah,
I own shares in the bus. It's a people mover. Do you know what those things are?
Yeah, they have them in Israel.
They have them in every third world country. Yeah. It's a whole bunch of people that jumps into one vehicle that has no seatbelts or anything.
Right.
It's a tin can with an engine, and then you drive.
It's kind of a taxi, but you pay a fare
instead of paying an amount. Yes, but it stops everywhere. Like it's not like there's no bus stop. You hail the taxi just like you guys do.
Was that a nightmare? To do that?
To be part of it?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, because it's like it's run by gangs, basically. So that's why I'm saying the other shares in my taxi were owned by, like, one of the like the gangsters that I had to basically go, would you let me drive a taxi? Then he said, will you have to give me shares? And I was like, of course I would. And I gave, you know.
You had to just buy you'd protection
you have
from
to
them?
Buy everything, yes, yes. You have to become part of the association.
Talk about that for 2 minutes.
So if you want a taxi, you have to be part of the association. To get into the association, you have to bribe somebody. So you bribe somebody, and then you become a member of the association. Now you have to get what they call a spot in the line. Do you get them? So you have to be in. There's a certain number of taxis allowed to be driving on any given route at any given time. So in order for you to get that number, you have to now pay money to somebody else. Most of the time, you'd buy it from a widower who had killed her husband, who had many taxi spots, and now she was selling off the spots, making the money because her husband's now dead because she probably killed him.
Why do you say, why would you make that kind of accusation?
Because it was known. I mean, these things are known in the township. When you kill someone, people
yeah,
knew
Neil,
about it.
These no, things are like, known in the township.
Like, you knew.
These bus drivers are dropping like flies. No one was like, hey, I think their wives are fucking
no, because
them.
Taxi violence in South Africa was... You see, have you... You know, like you watch the City of God and all of those?
Yeah.
That's how taxi violence was. It was literally guys out of their windows with AK-47s shooting people.
How much money were you making?
You could make a good amount. I'd say what? If you did really well, maybe $150 a day.
$150 and people are shooting over that.
Yeah, because then if you have $150 and I know guys that own 300 taxis, you do the math.
Okay. I'll do the math.
How much time
that's,
do you have?
It's all right, that's approximately...
can wait. We take a break?
If 150...
Wait, we don't have commercials?
Okay, if a ferry leaves
fuck.
Johannesburg...
I was never good with math. I knew...
The bottom line is these guys were really rich and it was tax-free and it was off the radar. It was just a crazy organization.
What is this?
Do the math.
All right, great. You're late.
P-A-S.
No, he's late. He's, all right, so...
he's late.
When did you... That's Doug.
He's late.
That's not a drop, ladies and gentlemen. That's just
that's
Doug lashing out.
He's late.
He's late. You were late.
Edit it out.
So you want me to do my impression of you?
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Sorry you're here for this, Trevor.
Yeah.
All right. And why did you start doing stand-up?
I went to a room with friends. We didn't have clubs. I think the first club opened 3 years ago. We never had comedy clubs. So there was a room.
That's amazing. They didn't have stand-up.
Most countries.
Well, stand-up was illegal. It was like if you went
Damn,
up and then
was illegal.
And then you made jokes about the government, they would come and arrest you. And if you were black, you couldn't even be in the establishment to make those jokes in the first place. So you were arrested on the way to the club.
You know, South Africa sounds like a really great place to grow up.
It is now. Yeah, it's amazing.
Is it really?
No, but it is. It really is a great place because we just there's nothing better than being in a place that has growth. And when you see change, you know, I travel and you know in America you guys are very disillusioned and you just. Oh, things are so bad here. And I'm like, no, they're not. Like, I watch your shows and they're like, this family who's bankrupt and da-da-da-da-da, and they don't even have this in their house. I'm like, they have a house? And then, you know?
You were... It's
right,
weren't
but it,
you on Extreme Makeover Outhouse Edition?
Long Drop Edition.
No, but my point is, I got to see the change, and you get to... It's a tumultuous process, but you get to be part
no,
of that.
I agree
you,
with
you know,
you.
It's... It's amazing.
How well, all right, you... so you started 6 years ago. When did you get famous in South Africa?
Well, hold on. I feel like we're jumping ahead. You had there was no stand-up infrastructure.
Yes. So
you're
I just went to.
You're like about to kill somebody's husband.
Did you have
a gun
during that period?
No, but my partner did. He had to buy one.
It's pronounced partner.
throw a click in there.
So you're in this kind of semi-gray industry. It's
yes.
Not, it's not quite
yes.
Above ground. And
in fact, it was just a side story. It was illegal at the time to operate these. When I was doing it. When they started out, taxis were illegal in the country. So
everything was illegal
yeah,
in
so
South
basically,
Africa.
No, so listen. So what they would do is, because basically the white government, these guys believed that black people had no ability to run themselves. They would make, like when the British government would come and go, why are you doing this to the black people? I remember one speech I watched where one of the guys, I don't know if it was Favut, one of the guys who started apartheid, he said, you must understand the black is the black cannot run his life. The black does not understand economics, and the black, if we were not here, these savages would kill each other.
And we are really the only reason they are still alive. So we are doing them a great favor. And this is what they believe.
No wonder they all left when they stopped apartheid. They're like, we fucked
so,
up.
You know where lots of them, you know right where now. You know where I met a lot of them? In Orange County.
Yeah?
I've met a ton of them. And then they come and talk to me like the country hasn't changed. So they basically greet me like I escaped. So they like they'll come to like a show in Irvine and they'll be like, hey Tirva! Man, it's wonderful to see. We watch your stuff on YouTube. We love it. Hey, it's great out here, isn't it? And I'm like, oh, it's great home. No, no, but I mean, you know, home is terrible.
Go ahead and run. I'll try to catch you.
It's terrible. It's terrible.
That's
and
then fucking you, awful.
And you're just like, we love your comedy so much. I'm like, well, I got to go to the bathroom. Not that, no, not that way, boy. Now you're going to have to go out back.
So then you start doing stand-up.
Yes.
And well, my question still remains. How did you go from this sort of gray market like industry to a how did you even decide to do stand-up if there wasn't an infrastructure?
I always believe you born as a stand-up. It's naturally what I developed. My stand-up came from my circumstances. I was always the odd one out. I didn't right. fit in. I was the I was too light to be black and I was too dark to be white. So it was always why are you like that?
You,
why are you like that? Why are you like that? You know. So then comedy became my out. You make people laugh. They no longer question who you are as a person.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, this is and my mom is a very funny person. My father is you know.
He seemed like that from afar. Anyway, he seemed very funny.
No, he's very funny. He's very dry though. From across very town. Dry. But my mom is and my grandfather.
He would send carrier pigeons with jokes.
And my grandfather. Just,
this is a good note.
Like my grandfather would get out of going to jail just by telling the police jokes. So if there was like, you know, if police would bust him for being in the city too late at night, instead of arresting, he'd tell them jokes and they'd let him go. And so my grandfather was very funny as well. And I always had that. So when I got into stand-up, it was just literally, I got on stage one night. There was an open
Where?
Mic thing.
There was a comedy open mic.
Yeah, it was a room.
Gotcha.
It was horrible. And my cousin got drunk and told the comedian that he was horrible. And he said, my cousin's funnier than you guys. Male bravado ensued. And then they said, well, why doesn't your cousin get on stage if he's so funny? And then I got...
You're Roseanne Barr.
Did that happen to Roseanne?
That's how Roseanne started, too.
Oh, okay.
Do you remember what your first joke was?
No, I don't even know what that first said. I basically just spoke to my friends.
Just did crowd work?
I didn't. No. I told jokes.
Because you were high on cat food at
friends.
The time, right? You had been eating that cat District 9 cat food. You can't even remember what was happening.
Cat food is just food. It's just it's labeled in a cat tin.
Is that hatred? is cat food just, a metaphor for regular food?
Just by the
Who
way, no, it's just.
all right. So how much time did you do?
I did 10 minutes, maybe.
And how did you do?
Well?
It was amazing. I felt at home. I had never felt more at home than when I just was like, that was normal for me.
You're like, this feels almost as home as
Comedians that were there, I'll never forget it. They cornered me backstage, and they thought I was from another city, and I had planned like this elaborate...
Right.
They thought it was theater, once again.
Yeah, right.
They were like, you planned this. You came here as an open mic guy, and you just wanted to upstage us, you asshole. Where are you really from, and what's the... You know what I mean?
Yeah.
This is the ultimate ego boost for the comic. First set, people are like, all right, fucking... Clearly a professional putting on a South African accent. You're an American stand-up who's been touring for a decade.
You're Eddie Murphy, aren't you? You're Eddie Murphy doing a
Trevor
character.
Noah is Eddie Murphy, and Eddie Murphy is Eddie Murphy.
Eddie Murphy is.
Oh, man.
All right, so you did good.
Great. Yes. And then I was hungry for it. I was addicted. It was a hit of crack, and I just kept going back. And I was like, I need to go.
Who's racist
to
now?
Find
look, I didn't bring up
to
crack.
Find
this guy did the blood of the color.
You know, no, but you know, it's funny. You say that, but crack back home is not that. If you did crack in South Africa, you were really well off. You couldn't afford crack in South Africa. That was just ridiculous.
Black don't crack.
What do poor people do, drug-wise?
Well, they couldn't afford drugs. Drugs wasn't... It wasn't a big thing back in the day. Now it's growing. Now you've got these drugs coming up. But drugs was... You got drunk. It was as simple
you got
as that.
Drunk. Okay.
You had homemade beer and you
Pete's
got drunk.
Stay in college.
That was it.
And off the crack.
I've never heard that drop before.
All right, and then how soon after that did you stand it?
So like, then I just regularly? Did, I just
every
I,
night.
No, I wish we don't have every night comedy. We have once a week
still?
Comedy.
Still, you don't?
Yes, yeah, still. You have once a week, twice a week comedy if you're very lucky. Then a room will pop up and then disappear. And then so I just wherever I could find comedy, I would do it. Wherever somebody would say we're going to be at a restaurant, there will be a microphone, we're going to tell jokes. I'd say please may I join
cool.
you?
How come you didn't just figure out a way to try to open your own thing?
You can't. We don't have that culture back home. No, we just don't. We don't have that culture. We don't. It stand up is so young in the country.
Or just go to a fucking restaurant and go, look, can I, after 10, can I?
But that's what people started doing. That's what I'm saying. But I was so new in this thing, I didn't. I mean, there had been guys who'd been doing it for a few years before me, so.
They were nowhere near as good as you.
They were, no, they were great. They were doing their thing. They were, they were basically.
Tell it to the DVD sales.
They were, they were basically the martyrs. And, well, they didn't release DVDs.
Oh, they killed them too?
They didn't.
Oh, no.
I bet they'd be happy to hear that you refer to them as the martyrs. Like, oh, the martyrs, the ones who died before
me. They who came before us.
Who died so that I could thrive and come to America.
Yeah, so, and then I just did it. Then it became, then.
How much better are you now than you were then?
Oh, I hope much better. I was a hack horrible. I mean, even now when I see gags from a year ago, I'm like, damn, I was a hack a year ago.
Just you calling them gags alone bothers me.
I still like to think of them as gags. I like.
Is that a thing though? Do they say that in South Africa? Gags.
It depends. Everyone has different things. I mean, what do you call them?
No, it just sounds like something that a terrible audience member tells you after a show. I saw your gag. It was really.
Oh, that's funny because back home they say skit or your.
Skit.
Or your
my mom says they go, that. Skit.
Yeah. And what is your skit going to be about?
That's what they ask us.
So they go, yes, or they go, your thing was very funny. Your talk. That's what we also get. Your talk was hilarious, by the way.
We were saying this weekend that. Speaking of black people, there's certain compliments that black guys will give you after a show or during a show that you have to know what they mean in order to know that they're compliments. So if a black dude goes, you're stupid, that's a high compliment. You think, thank you very much. Thank you.
My favorite is
you're stupid. Or a black dude come up to you and go, you were pretty good. And usually, if it's a white person saying that, you're like, fuck you, I was pretty good.
Yeah.
If it's a black dude saying, you're like, thanks, man.
Black is like hugging. Like, that means he wants to manage you.
Yeah, yeah. He was pretty good.
You were pretty good.
He was pretty good.
I like, you did your thing.
Yeah, you did your
you
thing.
You did your thing.
Black women will go, you funny.
Yeah.
Like, I saw you funny. I like that. Those are my favorite.
This white boy crazy. That's what I like.
I like when people say, oh, yeah, I saw you up there.
Yeah, I hate that.
Saw you up there. You look great up there.
Oh, I saw your spot.
I think the worst is when
I read your book.
When they say to the guy, they say to the guy next to you, they go, "Man, that was the best thing I've ever. That was the funniest, best ever. Oh, and you were great too."
Yeah.
Well, that's why when I'm on the road and I have my opener with, if I bring somebody, I tell them stand right next to me at the end of the show because I want them to compliment you. I don't want any of this. You should have been the headliner because I know I used to open for other people and hear people say it to me.
Yeah,
so I have them.
Yeah.
I stand them right next to me so we
they
can
can't
just,
give
wait,
me that.
So they can't do that horrible shit and I'll overhear it. If they're standing far enough. Yeah, if they're standing far enough away. I'm like, no, you preferred them.
Here's
that's a
secret.
Different thing.
You were actually my favorite.
Yeah. Yeah, and also, there's the other thing.
I'm right here, man.
Every fucking.
Oh, every show.
Yes.
Every show.
Yes.
And also, you want to go, well, being in the middle is easier. That's A.
And yes. People have preferences.
Yeah, and you're going to
you do great stand-up.
Like, you're going to naturally like one person's sense of humor better than another. That's fine.
We're being a little defensive. I'll admit that.
So when did you start becoming – when did it start popping for you?
It's so gradual. You don't. There's no.
It's not
there's
that
no.
Gradual.
It's not
that they've been doing it 6 years.
4 years.
I'm sorry. Six. You must remember. You guys have 6 years is long in America because you have a huge. I mean, your population is. In South Africa, we have 10% of our population is actually buying. So we have 4 million people that can actually afford something in the country. They can afford to buy a ticket to something or to have pay TV or. Do you get what I'm saying? So it's such a small market.
So it's a city.
Basically
an American city.
Yeah. Right. So basically, becoming big.
So you're
in
basically
South
like
Africa.
A fucking morning zoo DJ.
Yes, yeah. But it's true. But becoming big in a smaller place is not. That's why I don't like to think of it. It wasn't. It's in terms of the time. It's relative to how big the place is.
So
I mean, that's
do you
why
even consider that? You just see that's like a notch on your belt, and now you'll try to.
No. I mean, I love the fact that back home, like my fans are everything. They've literally given me everything. They give me the confidence to come out here because I go, okay, well, even if people look at me and go, oh, the monkey boy is trying to tell jokes in America.
That's just racism.
No, I've heard things like that out here. So I mean, because people,
monkey boy, smoke crack.
Because when you come out here, what do people expect? They expect you to be like I know when I got on stage, especially when I do lots of the urban shows. Just say black. I don't know why you guys say urban. It's a black show. Like when they say
we are not as bold as South Africans.
Yeah,
when we talk about race,
I call
we
black don't, shows. Huh?
No, but I'm just saying. You know, they're straight up going. Black neighborhood, colored neighborhood, white neighborhood.
They're pretty direct.
Yeah, but it was urban. Anyway, because I don't understand that. Because then they go, then they're like, oh, there's a great urban development coming up, but then there's only white people there. And then I didn't understand. So the point is, then I'd go to those shows, And guys, I remember one intro I got was at, it was a jazz club, and they had...
This is in South Africa.
No, this is in America. So it was in Hollywood somewhere, and they were singing.
Jazz club
No. They were singing. They were singing before the show. There was like a live band, like the Roots. And then people from the audience, it was like karaoke, but the best singers I've ever heard. I mean, just like dead on Michael Jackson.
Right.
There was no fun. It wasn't fun karaoke. It was,
right.
This is talent. Yeah. Yes, this is, I'm waiting to be discovered. And then the comedy started. And then I remember I'm sitting backstage and I just bought myself a pair of Crocs, you know, which are very comfortable.
You're trying to be white or what?
Comfortable.
That's just the white side of you buying.
And by the way, not those ugly ones with the holes in them.
Oh, the cool Crocs?
I bought the ones with the awesome Crocs. Calm yourself down.
Air Force Crocs.
Can you cut to the chase? You get the shit beat out of you in the story, I hope.
You get gay bashed?
Emotionally. Yes, emotionally. Yes, they beat me emotionally. That's what they did.
Only a man from another country would say no. Not the ugly Crocs, the other Crocs.
So then the guy says, I'm sitting backstage, and he goes, he waits, and then he points at another comedian in the backstage. He's like, "Hey, yo, you the dude from Africa?" And the guy's like, "Nah, man, I'm from Compton.
He's
a black guy, yeah."
Oh, God.
And then he goes, "Yo, they got a dude from Africa out here, right?" And I said, "Yes, I'm the guy from Africa." He's like, "Oh shit, oh they got light skinned cats over there." He's like, "Oh shit, I didn't even know, man." And he sits there and then he looks at and then he's like, "Yo, so y'all do comedy out there, man? Y'all got that? Yo, that shit must be hard, man. That shit must be hard, right?" I was like, "Why?" He's like, "Yo, man, because y'all got to tell monkey jokes and shit, right?" And no, but he wasn't being funny. He was really trying to learn. The guy, bless his soul, he was really trying to learn.
And he was going to South Africa the next day, and he'd written 20 minutes of monkey jokes.
Trust me. And the guy was just, you know, and then he looks at my Crocs, and then he's like, "Yo, those some African shoes, man. You got those things." Because they've got the holes in them, and they brown, and I can see what he thought.
Yeah, I can see what he thought, too. Nobody in America would wear some bullshit like that.
Exactly. So I go on stage, and when I come on, my intro was, "Hey, yo, check it out. Yo, this next dude coming to the stage. Y'all got to show him some love, man. We got this cat from the motherland out here. Yeah, that's right, y'all. He came all the way from the motherland. He be doing it out here for real. Y'all better show him some love. Make some noise for our brother all the way. Yeah, he's an OG. Give it up for Trevor Noah."
They had to give you Trevor.
I was like, "No, it's Trevor Noah. It doesn't change because I'm from Africa. It doesn't." But a lot of people did that. Even at the comedy store, the person bringing me up was like, "Yeah, oh, Trevor." So anyway,
they're giving you an American.
So
black
I go on stage.
Too.
I'd go on stage, and then I just tell jokes, just jokes that are jokes, and then the crowd just looked at me. No, they just looked at me.
Where's this motherfucking monkey joke?
And then I got off stage, and then it was they clapped. But it was very, okay, and then the guy came up to me and he's like, that was some shit, man. I mean, you know.
No monkey stuff for real. Like,
you know, and I think the guy who said it best was Tony Rock. He came on after me at a show called Chocolate Sundays. And he came on after me. The crowd was dead silent. I told all the jokes, and they were just quiet. It was just a speech. It was a foreign exchange speech.
Right.
And I got to a stage, and then Tony Rock said, "Yeah, I know what y'all motherfuckers are thinking. I was thinking the same thing. I was like, yo, they got light skins like that out there?" He's like, "Shit, that motherfucker sound more proper than we do, man. His English and shit? Man, I couldn't laugh at that shit. I was just listening." And it was just... And he came and he told me afterwards, he's like, "I'm sorry." He was like, we were just like, "Okay, where's this guy from and why is he making jokes about the KKK?" And you know what I mean? It was just...
You just fucked their minds up.
Yeah, so it didn't...
You also probably fucked their minds up with all those punchlines, man. You gotta talk about what to do next time you go.
You gotta act. You gotta fuck the stool.
That's racist. That is racist.
At least you didn't get booed off or swept off by the Sandman.
That's... By the what?
Are you doing about Sandman?
No.
You know Showtime at the Apollo?
Yes. Yeah.
So if you are on the amateur hour and they boo you off, then a kind of clown character called the Sandman comes out and sweeps you off stage.
Oh.
So that's bad.
Oh, okay.
Sometimes it doesn't mean
you didn't do bad.
Your mother dresses up as with a broom.
And she joins in.
And your dad points.
Your dad goes like, "My maid is here. I don't know this one, but that's my maid."
Oh, with the callback.
She's the Sandman. Can you walk down the street in South Africa without being recognized?
It depends on the street.
Yeah, like where? What city? In a big city?
No, look, I've done a few TV shows back home. Like I've had my.
I've
own.
Done a few TV shows too, and no, I but he do has not his own ever
show.
Get.
You've had like your own show.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, and then you know, so I've done those, and I've done a few ad campaigns, and.
So you're a celebrity in South Africa.
I guess so. Unfortunately, no. Not I wish. No, I wish, but no.
And what are you gonna? How long? Do you have a visa to stay here for? A long ass time.
I do. I'm here for about 3 years. So, but I go back and forth. I mean, like now, in July I'll be in Ireland at a comedy festival. In August I'll be in
Kilkenny?
Edinburgh.
Cat Laughs?
I think Kilkenny probably.
Yeah.
And then like August I'll be in Edinburgh. That's you know, yeah. Always wants to go there. And then September October back in South Africa. You know, just I go wherever. No, I'll be doing I'll be touring. Like,
oh, okay.
So
do you
South
do that festival?
South Africa and Namibia. I used to all the time.
Yeah, but you don't do, you're too big for it or something?
No. I just haven't been around
I'm
for a while.
I'm not talking shit.
I'm being for real. I haven't been around for a while.
There's one
Cape Town
Cape
Comedy
Town,
Festival.
Right.
Yeah. It used to be the biggest in the Southern
Trevor's
Hemisphere.
Trevor's going to get us all on that.
Hey, can we give you a tape? We're going to slip a tape in your bag.
Is your girl South African?
No.
Was she American?
No.
Where'd you find her?
Germany.
Oh, in Germany you found
yes.
it. Oh, interesting.
He was saying Germany was really nice.
Germany's amazing. That's
it's
the problem.
It's a really cool place.
As a Jew going to Germany, you go with this like, these motherfuckers, man.
And then they're really nice.
And they're so nice
and
fuckable
and they're very
and
apologetic.
Sweet
they
and awesome.
Just like...
Well, they don't apologize to you as a Jew.
No. But they,
go,
but
they
very,
like,
but they're
oh,
very,
sorry about the Holocaust.
The shame on the nation is so... Like, for instance, yeah. That's the one thing we never had in South Africa that I almost hated was the fact that... Like, our white people really got let off. There was no guilt trip at all. There was no, you know what I mean? They just like,
yeah.
Well, that was crazy. You know, whereas in Germany, they're just very like...
They still feel bad.
Yeah, they go, man, I'm really sorry. Like, for instance, they don't... Black people don't die in their horror movies. Like, uh-huh. Black people aren't the first. For real, black people do not die first in their horror movies.
In German horror movies?
Yes, because it's just... They can't kill the black guy
because
first
they don't
every
make
time.
Wait, what did they do to black people? They didn't do anything to black people.
No, but still, they don't want anything. They don't want anything to do with anything. Anyway.
No. If you only could have seen Trevor's hand when he was telling this German story. There's a full seagull in the middle of it.
It wasn't full. It was a semi.
Yeah, fair enough.
Yeah. So,
So you have this German girlfriend. And you found her in Germany and brought her here. She's in the States now.
No, I didn't bring her here.
Oh, she's still in Germany.
I travel the world. I've had girlfriends from many different places. It's like you know,
right.
it's just it's,
hey, look,
when
we're
you
all
when you travel.
Why,
no, when you travel, you're lucky enough to like. That's the thing. I've never gone. I only like white features, or I only have. You know what I mean?
Are you doing an impression of me?
No, I didn't.
I only like
because that's not how you speak.
I'm Neil.
Hi. He was late.
So, you know, that like that, I feel sorry for people who cannot see the difference between, like, I've met many white people in America or anywhere in the world who can't see a good-looking black person at all. They cannot.
Right.
They, like, I remember once I was with this girl in South Africa and she was colored. And we lying in bed and she turns to me and she goes, hey, I was watching your show the other day and... you had this model that was on, and she was really beautiful. I said, oh, yeah, she is. Her name's Joelle Kayembe. I was like, yeah, she's really beautiful. She goes, yeah. And I don't normally find black people good-looking. I said, you mean you've never seen a good-looking black person to this point in your life? She said, no. I don't think black people can be good-looking. That's why I was shocked that girl was. And I said, what do you mean? You can't say an entire race
and this girl's
is not
mixed.
Good-looking. Yes.
Fuck.
And then she said, no, black people cannot be good looking. I said, but what do you mean? And she said, well, because they smell like onions. And so I said...
Smelling or looking?
And I said, no, she said they smell
this
like
girl
onions.
Girl sounds bright. Let me
and
just
so
say
And so I
that.
Said, no, but you know what? Funny enough, Moshe, she wasn't dumb. She really wasn't... She like in a normal conversation, she could hold her own. And then all of a sudden you're going... Wait, where is this? And she said, they smell like onions.
All of a sudden, the black person would show up, and her eyes would tear up.
It's that they all have to walk away.
And I said, could it not be possible that the few black people you have encountered may have had a general odor of onions because of one person in their vicinity? And she said, no, every black person I've ever smelled smells like onions.
And you're like, where are you from? She's like, Onion Town.
And I said...
little Onionville.
And why I'm from Onion Town? Why do you ask?
And it was just like, you know, she couldn't even see how racist she just couldn't.
So what do you got coming up next? Anything exciting you want to talk about, or do you
exciting as in personal or
career wise? You're here in the States. Things are
you're on the Tonight
well.
Show a lot, right? Any
I popped in now and again. I don't know if a lot is a. I just tell jokes on the road. That's what I do.
So go see Trevor. What's your website?
Trevor Noah. Do people go to websites anymore?
Absolutely,
I'm on Twitter.
Yeah,
Trevor Noah.
On Twitter. Yeah. At Trevor Noah.
Yes, at Trevor Noah.
Can you say in Zulu or Swazi? You're fucking.
I don't speak Swazi.
Okay, so
I speak Zulu, Xhosa, Sotho.
Can you say you're fucking with the champs in different African languages?
The word fuck doesn't exist.
Oh, okay. You're messing with the champs. You are involved with the champs.
Let me think.
Take us out with just one great. You are now involved with the champs.
Put a click in it.
We would appreciate it.
You definitely want to put a click.
Or a clack.
We got to get the click.
Okay.
Fuck with the champs.
Let's try something. Ningazostrela ngoba sendlala nama champs.
Smell of gasoline.